that.
But it has always belonged to Mary and Mary alone.
It's not, is it? It's not just me, old drunk guy. Is it just me?
Come here all the time.
We know.
No problem. Not
we
a,
come out
not
here
a,
all the time.
Not a problem.
Just so, not right here.
Can I have some food, please?
You don't look.
Yeah, I think we've done something good here.
Apart from the smashing that shop up, but if you want to make an omelette, you've got to put the stove on and put eggs in it and cook the eggs until you've got an omelette, and then you eat the omelette.
I basically play a James Bond figure. And I've got to rescue all these women hostages, and they're naked because all their clothes have rotted off.
Okay, well, so for the viewers watching, let's see you do some magic on me via a Zoom call. Let's do it now.
Okay, well, you asked for it. I'm gonna do a big old magical tractor beam on you.
Yep, still here. Absolutely fine, mate.
Did anything happen?
Nope, nothing happened. I think we've gotten everything we need from this interview, Eddie. I wish you all the best, but...
B?
Watch out, Kara!
B? Is it Bob and Weave? Bob and Weave? Bob and Weave? A? B? Eat! Mash! I'm mashing it! I'm mashing!
This is gonna be 100% orc proof.
As everyone knows, twigs are an orc's worst enemy. Terrified of them. If an orc sees a twig, it will brick it, it will shit itself.
What, lads? Hey, how you doing? Good. Yeah, good man, good. Drinks, yeah. Get me, No. No beer for me, mate. Nah. I'm off drink. Yeah, and I've not had a drink for a while now, so. Yeah, no. Yeah, no, he knows what I'm like. I'll have one and then I'll have another one. Nah, mate. Hey, I'm crazy enough without it. Oh, put myself in the eye. Nah. Yeah. Nah, I'm good, honestly, mate. Nah. Why? I don't want one, mate. I just told you I don't want one. Because last time I had one, it made me want to kill my old self. Like that. Oh, I've lost all my self-esteem and self-worth. Shut up. You know what I mean? So now, I'll just have an orange juice, please. Thanks.
It's great that. It's called telling lies, by the way. It's really good. Once you get over the sort
of... How was your day? Tell me.
The shit, how shit it is. It's what? Actually really good. You've got to rewind everything, but that's part of it. It's kind of real, isn't it? How you've got to rewind things like a tape on a computer screen. Oh, it's buzzing. Nah, honestly, it is buzzing. Once you get over that. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm aware of that. That was all linked into drinking as well. Perfectionism, everything not being good enough, and I'm sure anyone watching this will relate to what I'm saying. I know it's not just me, there's nothing special about me or any of these problems, and it's an illusion to think that I am special or that these things are just exclusive to my own experience. They're not, are they? It's everywhere, and constantly bombarded with high standards and polished results, as I've mentioned before, is not helpful, is it? That definitely perpetuates that. The idea of not being enough, of not being good enough, needing to be more, to achieve more, it's all bullshit. It's absolute bullshit. I think this is, I don't even know if this was planned, it's one of those great moments in a film where you are just watching two people exist on screen, and the lines between the actors and the characters and the relationship sort of disappear, and you're just watching life. Choice like that. Nicholas, I'm calling him an actor, he's got a frog head on, but you know, he's having fun with it. He's not trying to be, you know, he's not trying to win any Oscars. He's just giving himself a bold choice, and that delivery.
Well, yes, bold.
Shuts your hole!
Can't get the time signature.
What's your new restaurant called?
Fetish Diner.
Nice. That's catchy, isn't it?
Yes.
What sort of cuisine do you serve? Like, is it got like a Halloween theme?
Yes. It's just pudding.
It's just pudding.
Yes, pudding.
Mate, I'm just stepping to the shop. Do you want anything?
How are you doing, guys? Welcome back to the Quiet Dog Podcast with me, Adam Jowett. How the hell are you doing? Hope you're well. Jumping on at a slightly earlier time than normal today. Because I wasn't on yesterday. Because I was out. So I thought I'd come and jump on now at this sort of slightly unorthodox time of 5 p.m. Because I'm going out tonight. So how's it going? Tell me what you've been doing. Tell me all about it. Oh, yeah. Oh, that's pretty cool. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, fuck, right, okay. Really? Oh, that's pretty cool. Me? What have I been doing? Well, oh, God, where shall I start? So many things going through my head right now. I've had a nap. I had a nap before, so that was pretty good. Pretty good. Had a nap. Still feel tired. Some days you're just tired, aren't you? Just tired all fucking day. When does it end? And then I thought, I'm too tired to do a stream. I'm too tired. I'm not enjoying it. The little voice in my head saying, you're too tired, Adam. And you're obviously not enjoying it. Otherwise you'd be doing it. You're obviously not enjoying it, Adam. So just give up. It's okay to just give up and not do it. And the more I thought, you know what, I'm just going to come on for an hour and see what comes out of the old brain box. There's so many things flying around in there at the moment. And I'm out later on, as I say, so yeah, just jump on for a bit, see what happens. Let me just put a little thing on here, because if people come in, I want there to be a sort of topic of conversation, because I was talking about this recently with somebody, and I want to know, alert. Have you ever seen
a ghost. Okay, so if someone comes in and like, what's all this? Have I seen a ghost? No, I don't think anyone will. But you never know. It's there if people want to come in and tell me a bit about that. Because I haven't. I've never seen a ghost. Part of me wishes I had. I genuinely mean that. I'm not trying to disturb any spirits here. But if you are here, what are you waiting for? Where's the footage? There's no footage of one, is there? Otherwise, it'd be everywhere. There's just silly videos. Just people being silly. Most Haunted, it's the same. It's the same episode over and over. It's a bunch of people who obviously have some belief in the supernatural. Put them into a building which has got a lot of history behind it and a lot of folklore behind it. You plant the seed in their mind and then turn all the lights off and just let the cameras roll and watch them scare the shit out of each other. They're shouting at each other. They're screaming at each other. There's no ghost there. It doesn't. I think it's entertaining, but not for the reasons that maybe most people think. Because I just don't believe in it. I think it's a load of nonsense. Having said that, though, what was the is it the Enfield Hauntings? That was pretty freaky. I think it was in Pontefract. And The Conjuring did a film about it. The Conjuring, the series of films, The Conjuring, they did one where they came over to England, over to the old UK, and they done a film about ghosts up in the north. Let's have a look. They done a film about it up in the north, where there'd been some disturbances by paranormal activity. And it were right queer, it were. People weren't sure what were going on, but there was something not normal. Enfield Haunting. Now, fair warning here, this may well put the willies up you. Oh, so they've got their own website. Here we go. Let me just change the, because we might stay on this. This is the Kiss of Death now. If I change the stream title to Just Chatting, I'll very quickly run out of steam. And I'll just start playing the game and I'll change it back again. Just Chatting. So this is it. Are we all sitting comfortably? The Enfield Haunting is one of the most widely debated hauntings of the 20th century. From 1977 to 1979, two sisters from Enfield, England. Enfield isn't Pontefract. It's near Pontefract, I think, because I have a friend who lives there. And he mentioned it was near him. Or maybe I'm just chatting absolute shite. Yeah. Enfield. No, that's Enfields. That's an estate agent. Where is Enfield, please? It's a suburb in London. I was way off. Oh, you stupid bastard, Adam. You stupid bastard. So where's the one in Pontefract then that he was on about? What he were on about? Pontefract. Haunting.
because they did.
Oh, I mean, it looks fucking. I mean, look at that. That's terrifying anyway, isn't it? Look at that gas fire. Look at the carpet. Jesus. This is one I'm slightly more interested in. Reports of poltergeist activity at 30 East Drive disappeared in the national newspaper after a family living in the house, the Pritchards, claim they're experiencing supernatural goings on. Ah, I think where I've become confused is I listened to a podcast about this. They're all the same, aren't they, really? They're all quite similar. So the interesting thing is that it was the whole family were experiencing odd goings on. The Pritchards were Jean and Joe and their two children, 15-year-old son Philip and 12-year-old daughter Diane. It was Philip and his grandmother who witnessed the first creepy occurrence in the house. Chalk-like dust falling from below the ceiling. Paranormal activity soon escalated and became much more violent. On one occasion, a large grandfather clock. Oh, I thought it was. I mean, if you'd have just left it at grandfather. A large grandfather on the landing toppled over and tumbled down the stairs and smash. That's the sentence. On one occasion, a large grandfather clock on the landing toppled over and tumbled down the stairs and smash. That's weird. Even this was tame in compared. Jesus. Do you see what I'm on about? They don't help the cause, do they? This is quite possibly written by a 12-year-old. Even this was tame and compared to the night that Diane was dragged up the stairs by an invisible force. The young girl was standing at the bottom of the stairs when she felt a strange sudden sensation. Her long hair started to stand on its end. Without warning, she was suddenly flung to the ground and dragged kicking and screaming up the stairs soon after the event. Yeah, it is creepy, isn't it? And I don't know. That's the thing. I'm just saying I don't believe. I'm not saying I don't know. Ah, Most Haunted did do a thing there. There she is. What's her name? Not Claudia Winkleman. Yvette Fielding. Oh, and there was a film made about it. When the Lights Went Out. Yes. Although the movie does go a little overboard towards the end, the plot handles the beginning of the haunting is very... The way the plot handles the beginning of the haunting is very consistent with the real-life accounts. The film is set in the 60s, and the makers have done a great job of recreating life in that period in a council house in the north of England. From clothing to props and lifestyle, this movie feels very real. Oh, you can go and visit the house. That's nice. It's not just TV crews and movie producers who've visited the house. You can too. There are several paranormal events companies. Oh, they'll be making a fucking fortune, won't they? They'll be raking it in, they will. Laughing all the way to the bank. Like a rat up a drain pipe. I know I'm taking the piss out of it, but I also do think it's interesting. I know I've told this story before, but my mother, when she was, I don't know, maybe like 13, 14, something like that, and she used to come home from school at dinner time, she went home, and she was the only one in the house, and she had the radio on, and she was dancing in front of the mirror, and there was a big metal letter rack on the shelf next to the mirror. And she said it flew from the shelf to the and hit the wall behind her.
and she fled. She fled for her life. And she tells that story a lot, and she says that her mum didn't believe her, her dad didn't believe her, no one believed her. What's all that about? It's unexplained. And then it begs the question, did it really happen? I'm not saying my mum's a liar. She's not a liar. I don't think she is, but false memories are a thing. Did it do that? Or did it just, was it behind her anyway, and it maybe just fell off the shelf? I mean, I believe in science as well. I'm a science guy. Sue me. But there's something to do with, you know, electricity. Things being charged. I did go to a... Whatchamacallit? There's a ghost walk in Manchester. And Manchester has a big network of underground tunnels and like shelters and bunkers. Let me see if I can just Google it. Manchester Underground. It is pretty cool. Look at that. This is all... I mean, I don't even know what the... you know, the historical relevance of it all is. Like, what it was used for. But I think this is where... Disused toilets in the arches... Oh, so they were used in the 60s. Don't know if this is where we went. Station Goods Yard, Manchester and Salford Junction Canal Tunnel. Anyway, this guy... Let me Google Manchester Ghost Walk, see if I can find it. Ghost Walk. And there's a Chorlton Ghost Walk. Hey, Cavs. Thanks for the lurk. Yeah, so this... I think this was it. I don't know what date this is. Yeah, that's the guy. I think... Genuine ghost stories that are moving, dramatic and real. Stories and tales involve Manchester's Tudor magician. Dead opera singers. And the tear catcher tale. The tear catcher tale. The Manchester shouter. A visitation from the devil. And a whole cast of curious characters from the dark heart of the city. Guests are even instructed how to communicate with the dead in Manchester. The tour starts in St. Anne's Square. No, this isn't the one we did. And moves to an old graveyard for a tale of hanging, drawing and quartering, the cruelest of deaths, and one reserved for traitors. Then approaching through back alleyways with their own twisted stories, the tour party reach the entrance to a Manchester underworld where in the dark there are more tales. There is no illumination except that provided by the guide. In the silence, it is not unheard of to feel the spirits move. Expect fabulous storytelling and drama and laughter on a memorable tour. That is not the one I went on, because the one I went on, I felt like I was going to die. I genuinely did. I think this is the one. Lecky, oh yeah, this is him. This is him. This guy here. Oh, I was hanging out my arse as well. Me and my girlfriend at the time had had a heavy night the night before. Oh, it was... original Manchester Ghost Walk. I think it might have been this one.
Yeah. Well, oh yeah, I remember watching this, but this does not tell you much about the... you know, what the actual Ghost Walk entails. So, we were literally underground. There's a place called the AMC in Manchester, which is like, I think it used to be a train station. I gotta keep doing that. There you go. Used to be an underground, some kind of station. I don't know. As I say, it wasn't quite clear what was going on, but it could have had a lot to do with how hungover I was. But we definitely heard stuff in the silence. There was it definitely sounded like someone was walking up some steps above us. Apparently there was nothing above us, but it may well have been someone walking up some steps above us. That's a very likely possibility, isn't it? My stepdad, however, he's very attuned to these kind of things, and I'm sure he won't mind me sharing this, but he had some very weird experiences when he was younger. And his sister, where their house in Hyde somewhere, a fairly old house they used to live in, and him and his sister used to there's one occasion in particular where the babysitters like friends of the family, one night Ian and Dawn, my stepdad and his sister, they were upstairs in bed, and when their mum and dad got home, the two babysitters were sat on the doorstep, and they were like, "What's going on?" And they said, "We're not going back in there." And they said, "Why not?" And they said, "Because we can hear someone breathing behind the TV." Not making that up. Not, that's exactly what he said. Other things like hearing walking and stopping outside the door, and there'd be no one outside the door. So they were both pretty terrified by that. So he's a big believer in paranormal activity, the afterlife. He's told me stories of like when him and my mum have gone away somewhere, he's felt this sort of if they're staying in an old B&B, like an old, there was an old sort of villa in France that they stayed in, and both him and my mum said when they got back that as soon as they got there, they felt this sort of like an unwelcoming vibe, but they didn't say anything to each other until after they'd left, because they didn't want to give it energy. Do you know what I mean? So Ian had you know, he'll talk to them. And again, I'm sure he won't mind me saying this, but he'll ward them off. He'll say things like, listen, guys, I'm just here for I mean no harm. I'm a good man. I'm here for a nice holiday. So let's just keep this civil, shall we? Let's just keep this nice and civil, all right? And there won't be any problems for either of us. We'll keep to our plane. You keep to your plane. And we can both just exist here together. I don't want any trouble, all right? I haven't got any cameras. I'm not going to do any Ouija boards. So he'll do that with absolute conviction. So anyway, this guy, Lecky Bennett here, he singled my stepdad out. Me and my girlfriend at the time, we were just trying to stave off a panic attack. We were just trying to get through it because it was pitch black. It was very uncomfortable. It was very intense.
But Ian got picked out and he said something like, I don't know, it was like a sort of cold reading routine. Like, he got Ian to stand in the middle of a circle, we were all surrounding him, and sit in a chair. And he said something like, I'm probably misremembering this, but the way I remember it, he said something like he could feel something around his throat. Something like that. He kind of got him to close his eyes and just kind of say what he was experiencing, as if he was sort of channeling something or someone. And Ian went along with it, and he didn't start talking in a little girl's voice or anything like that. He just said that he felt he's kind of doing this, like, I feel something around my throat. And then afterwards, the guy said, you know, it's funny you should say that, Ian, because in 1577, the young girl was actually hung here. Something like that. And I remember at the time it being very... That obviously sounds like he's just made that up afterwards. But at the time, I don't know if it happened that way around. I don't know if it was that bluntly obvious that it was obviously just a bit of shtick that he was doing. But it shat us up anyway. It shat all of us up. Put the willies right up us. So, I don't know. It's the power of suggestion, isn't it? I don't believe there's an afterlife. Let me put it that way. I think when you die, you are dead. You are dead, 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 dead. Dead. Bill Burr said something like, we don't help ourselves by giving ourselves funerals and burials and making ourselves dolling up our own corpses so they're nice and beautifully laid out, nice ornate clothes, really, you know, angelic looking. We give ourselves a lovely send off. We play our favourite music, sort of sailing off into the ocean, or scattering our ashes on our favourite bench in the favourite park. He said, if you're driving on the motorway and you see a dead fox, it's just been smashed to bits by a car, like, it's dead. It's fucking dead. It was alive 1 minute and then it got hit by a car, and that is just nothing. It's just matter on the concrete. But we attach all these stories to things. I am trying to keep this light, but there's no one here, so this is what happens. All right, Cavs, you're here. You're cool. I'm not having a go. Just saying. If you don't like it, this is what happens when I'm left to my own devices. But it's true. It's true. I think the afterlife is just something we've coined to make living a bit more bearable. You know, it's not just look. The fact if there's nothing, what there's no us to experience the nothing. So what difference does it make? And same goes for loved ones that have passed on, passed over. I suppose it's like, maybe it's a bit like Father Christmas. It's, you know, you try and explain death to a young kid. Daddy, what's happened to Nana now that she's died? She's dead, son. She's gone. She's gone. You see that? Come here, son. Come here. You see that? That badger, you know, that badger on the road that got hit a few weeks ago, wasn't it? I mean, that was quite big, wasn't it, when it got hit? And now it's just sort of, it's decaying, isn't it? That's what's going to happen to Nana, but in the ground. She's not looking down on us or anything like that. It's just, you just picture of like a void. A what? A void, you know, as if like nothingness. That's what happens. No, you don't say that. No one in the right mind would say that. You'd have to be a mentalist. If I had kids, I obviously wouldn't say that to them. You'd say, Nana's gone to heaven. She's looking down on us. She's in a better place. She's happy. For once in her life, she's happy. So who am I? I am nobody. Talking into the void once more. Should we play a game where I am a cat? We could do that, couldn't we? Let's lighten the mood a bit. Oh, before I do that, I'll chat a bit about this one. I'm playing cat. Don't give me updates now, please. Not now. I tell you, I've put this headphones straight into the mic, and it's I think I'm into it. So I can hear myself, and it's less like I'm being smothered to death by my own thoughts. It's quite it was a bit weird at first, but I'm getting used to it. Right then, let's get you on, you fucker. We'll keep the rain on in the background because I quite like that. We'll turn that right down. So we'll turn the desktop volume up to about there. We'll turn that. Should be all right. Just a little smidge there. Get rid of some of this shit. And let's do this here. Ladies and gentlemen, it's time to cat. So, when we last left off, our furry friend, he just got a little robot backpack and a robot friend. Just to forward the gaming dynamics a little bit, because it was getting a little bit on one note. So now you'll see I've got this little groovy little thing on my back, which I'm not quite sure what that does yet, but I'm sure it's going to be a lot of fun. Keys, use item. So this thing can just help me move shit about. It's got like a nice, there you go, little tools. Oh, what's the code? I don't know what the code is. What was the code? I don't know. It did show me how to open up some sort of menu, but I've gone and bloody forgotten, haven't I? Like an absolute idiot. Oh, here she is. Calm down, everyone, it's fine. 3748. Assuming the volume's okay. Looks okay to me. Three. 3748. Door opening. I need to get out of this apartment. Let's try the main door. I should be able to get it open. Please lead the way. I was around at my mum and Ian's last night playing with their cats. Cats are very hit and miss for me, isn't it? The elevator in the distance, that's important. I know we need to go off. Cats, they either love me or they're just not arsed at all. Well, I say they love me, they love people in general. They can be very affectionate and, you know, cuddly, responsive. Sort of like up for a bit of a buzz. Other cats are just like, stay the fuck away from me. What?
You think you're going to touch me? Do that thing, like... and stroke them, just... like that. Makes you feel very, not wanted. But these cats are buzzers. Well, one of them in particular, Jake, he's up for it. He's up for a good old cuddle. He's a buzzer. Right, I remember the outside. Feels like I've been there before. Is this where you came from? I guess so. I promised someone I would go there. Who is who? This postcard. The mural was painted from it. Let's take it. Okay. Sure. Whatever floats your boat. Zoom in slightly there, like that. I hope you're not having an existential crisis, B12, because I'm a cat. I don't know how I'm going to help you. Pardon me. Let's cat. I know I mentioned this on the last stream, but cats, I'm very on the fence about. Part of me would love a cat, part of me feels that if I got the wrong type of cat, what if it hates me? What if it... Ah! Oh, get off me, please! Oh, God! Oh! Please! I'm your friend! There's a place in Manchester called the Cat Cafe, and it's exactly what it sounds like. You go in there, you pay a pretty healthy admission fee, and it's a cafe, right? Where there's cats in it, and the cats all look depressed as fuck. Not that I've been in a brothel, but it's like that sort of environment of they're just there, like they're just sick of fucking human beings. Like, and they just stay as far away from people as possible. They don't want to be touched. They don't want to be bothered. They're just like... It's not a nice dynamic. It's like you've paid money to be in there to touch cats. It's like... It's not right. It doesn't feel right. It doesn't feel fair. You just feel bad for the cats. If it was dogs, on the other hand, dogs are a bit more like... A bit more friendly, aren't they? What's going on? Something's happening. Why can't I run fast? Why has the music changed? You there. Is there a glitch in the game? Seems like it's quite loud now. Sorry. Just knock it down slightly. I think that's helped at all. Okay. Why can't I run? You there. Friend or foe? Are you gonna fight? sweet cat. They seem to have their own language. You're no Turk. You're no Zerk. We're not familiar with your kind. You are welcome in our village, as long as you don't eat anyone. Oh, this is Guardian. This is the big fella saying this. Is it? It's kooky, that's for sure. You look lost. What do you need? Showing that? Oh, a picture of the outside. Ridiculous. This elevator isn't operational. Everyone knows that it is impossible to leave this place. Well, except the outsiders. But they're all gone now. Except Momo. Wasn't Momo like a creepy pasta thing? Momo, pretty sure it was. Can't Google out here anyway, just in case. You can try to talk with him if you want, but he gave up on trying to leave. It's for the best. He lives high up in that building with the orange neon sign. And talk to Momo about getting out then, shall we? Okay. Opening up a bit now. Hello there. This looks very chilled. What have you all taken? You gave us such a fright, we thought you were a Zerk. Show item. Ooh, very pretty. What else have you got to say? Okay. They're all meditating, aren't they? Or just napping? Really thought you'd take the elevator. I've never seen that thing work, and I'll be 374 years old tomorrow. Why go up there? There's nothing there. Only your ancestors can distinguish these colours. It is said they once dominated the world. Fantastic. That's fantastic. I take care of the plants. The humans improve them so much, now they require very little light. I just add a bit of water and look how big they get. It really is an amazing technology. Plants are great, aren't they? I was thinking the other day I need to get some actual real plants, not like that fake monstrosity behind me. It's not a monstrosity, it's just very it's very, very not real. Apparently plants are good for the oxygen in your environment, so I was thinking of getting a few. They're quite expensive though, some of them, aren't they? If you get a really nice big one. Oh, look, he's got a bag on his head. You daft cat. Fucking hell. Oh, now he can't walk properly. He's going in different wrong directions. That's very good. Just a bit of playful game mechanics there. Ever so charming. Oh, what's he doing there? Plays a song, mate. Hello, I'm a musician, but I don't have any songs. Oh, a blue sky, ha, I will write a song about that one day. You do that. Oh, he's having a little kip. No,
have a little kit, mate. Let's all have a little kit. Let's all have a little kit. So, right, I was watching Better Call Saul, right? And I thought. Last time I watched it, I thought that was the last episode, foolishly. And I came on here and I was talking about how people were, obviously people compare it to Breaking Bad. Some people say they prefer Better Call Saul. I have my reasons for thinking that those people are idiots. No, I don't think that. But I do think that Bryan Cranston compared to Bob Odenkirk is like comparing apples and oranges. Comparing the shows are like comparing apples and oranges. One is an apple, one is an orange. That's all there is to it. They're both very well written. Anyway, I thought the way it was rounded off was nice. But obviously there's more to it. So I watched a newer episode the other night, and it's opened up a few more doors now. And I'm like, oh, this is interesting. So it's all to play for, is what I'm saying. I've just said that midnight is important in desperate situations. Very true. These are certainly desperate times. New memory recovered. I might try and put like a side, what do they call it? Like a side ducking chain, so that the, let's see if I can do it now. And desktop audio, filters, edit filters, limiter, noise suppression, noise gate, gain limiter, expander, compressor. That's not what I want. Noise suppression is not what I want. No. Gain. Plugin. No. Limiter. No, it's none of that. It's not a filter, is it? It's a, properties. Let's look. No, I'll have to do it off stream. Do it off stream. Yeah, it basically means that the desktop audio dips slightly when I start talking, and the volume dips. So I have to keep my eye on how loud the game is. So yeah, I've been rewatching Breaking Bad, and just from the first six episodes, I'm like, this is just the whole setup, the whole characters, the setup, the tone of it, the violence, the how dark it is, how the story of a man and his own hubris, not wanting to accept help, and the whole, you know, throwing the American health system and how it can break good people like that, and underneath everything, it's the inversion of the hero story, the subversion of the hero, the anti-hero, like the Macbeth character, you know, seeing someone good become bad. But every step of the way, that's what I mean, the setup is so good, because every step of the way, you're like, why the fuck wouldn't you, why don't you just take the money to get the healthcare, to get the treatment for cancer? He's given so many opportunities for a way out. And then the writing is so good at straddling the two arguments of where Walt's coming from and where his family are coming from. Like, when he does decide to start cooking meth, and the bigger part of you is with him. And I think that's very, that's a testament to the craft of the writing. I think the characters are much more relatable. Better Call Saul is, I like the, I think it's very clever, all the different plots and schemes that Jimmy McGill comes up with, and the Rhea Seahorn character. Like you said, there's no comparison, but there is a lot to compare. But my main reasons why I think Better Call Saul, Breaking Bad is better than Better Call Saul is the acting. I think Bryan Cranston is just leagues above Bob Odenkirk in terms of the choices that he makes, how relaxed he is, the dynamism of the actions that he chooses, the ups and downs, you know what I mean. You make your own mind up. Don't let me tell you what to think. Please don't bother Vapora. She's so clumsy. Who's this, though? Oh, he's talking about... Mito is talking about Vapora. Okay, thanks for the heads up. I think there's a thing where... It does tell you which way to go. Circles of light are pleasing to watch, but I want to see the real sky one day. So they're in some kind of dome. Some kind of futuristic dome. Nice little kip, just a little kip. Let's have a little question, shall we? Just a little question. Oh. I wrote a note here that says, how has Jeremy Vine not killed himself yet? I don't know if any of you know who Jeremy Vine is, but he's a Radio 2 talk show host. He does this thing every day where members of the public phone up. He chooses music sheet. So that's the music man. They basically just open the airwaves to any Tom, Dick, or Harriet to just fucking moan, and he'll say the most inflammatory setups to the topics of conversation, like, I don't know, why are pigeons ruining our bins? Did you know that pigeons have become racist? Studies now show, and people phone up saying, yeah, I saw a pigeon the other day and it was being racist to other pigeons, and I thought, this is because of Brexit, isn't it? And Jeremy Vine's like, yeah, well, that's not to say that, you know, chickens aren't worse, you know, just bollocking on and on and on and on and on and on. A never-ending debate. And I can't have it on at work anymore. Or if it is on, that's the reason I wear headphones at work now. And I listen to Limmy's stream. I'd much rather listen to Limmy talking absolute rubbish, but entertaining rubbish, then, as I say, just this never-ending, exacerbated, drawn-out moan fest. They're all just moaning. Moan, moan, moan. And I just think, How do you do this every day? How do you have the gall to sit there and contribute to this barrage of wank? It's unbearable. Genuinely, it's unbearable. I can't stand his voice. I can't stand the tone of his voice. The people that phone in, it just makes me go like this. I hate everything about Radio 2. I hate Radio 2 and I hate anyone who listens to Radio 2. You're all deceitful cowards. I hate the false niceness. I hate false upbeatness. Zoe Ball, she's another one. She can get to fuck. No one is that happy all the time. No one. It's okay not to be that happy. It's okay. You can be... Zoe, just be you. You're enough. Jeremy Vine, you're enough. When it's 8:30 in the morning, let's just take the pressure right off everybody to be on. We can all let's just give us time to wake up. You just talk at a normal, I'm not going to do it now because it is annoying, but this sort of false, it's not real. And it makes me sad. You've made me sad now, Zoe. I'm sure Zoe Ball is lovely in person, and I'm sure Jeremy Vine is. I just don't like that. So that's that. That's me slagging off other people moaning. That's me moaning about other people moaning, which is not the same thing. They started it. They absolutely started it. It's getting up to an hour, guys, so I'm going to call it a day very soon. I need to have some tea and I need to get ready to go out because I'm doing my Five Rhythms thing tonight. Fifteen minutes since last checkpoint. Oh, I need to find a checkpoint then, don't I? I need to find myself a little checkpoint.
Jump!
Ooh, you're gonna have a good time. How to develop your artificial intelligence in order to be as creative as a real human, volume 42. Like in the little dystopian thing that's developing here. Quite creative. Sheet music for the music man. Some of that. Meow. This aesthetic. Hey Doc, I found the keys to your safe. You need to be more careful with these. Translation. Gain new item. Keys to a safe. It's not enough to bury your safe behind a bunch of books. I think that's a clue as to where this safe is. I think. It's under some box. Bit of a scratch on there, mate. Let's see, scratch the fuck out of it. Scratch the fuck out of that. fucking ruin it. Yes. You feel better after that. Nice little scratch. Can I... Oh no, I can't just save it. I've got to progress the story, Adam. So the pressure's on now. The pressure's on because you're going to be very late if you don't stop soon. You're going to be quite late. Either that or you're not going to eat. And you're going to do your five rhythms and you're going to pass out because you're going to be going mental. Right. Let's go through this systematically. Let's go hug the left, as they say. Hug the left. And we'll look for a safe. Something up there. Let's just go back around there. Let's see if I can get... Can I get... Oh, what's that? Yes. Oh. No, I've got time for that. There's no time for sleeping.
This isn't the time to panic. This is the perfect time to panic.
Okay, so I've abandoned the hug the left wall. I've abandoned that now. We're just sort of wandering, which is, that's fine as well. The thing about that is there's no system here, Adam, is there? There's no system. There's a safe. Was there ever any doubt? Give me that. Strange notebook with a symbol on it. This one seems to belong to someone named Doc. After weeks of research, I've combined a spectrometer with a powerful UV lamp. With this, we should be capable of warding off the Zerks on our way out. We don't know... The initial attempt was explosive. I might have to test it under real conditions. I don't know what this means, but it'll probably be useful later. Let's go see that Momo person who Guardian told us about. Alright then. Some kind of weapon. Where's this Momo dude then? Right. That's a save. That's the checkpoint there. That's a checkpoint. Guys, you've been lovely. I've been on tremendous form once again. I always am. I always surprise myself when I come on here. I think, oh, can't be bothered. I come on here, I'm amazing. And I just think, what was everyone so worried about? So, thanks to me for making all of this happen, especially. Let's see who's online. Oh, let's go to, we've got a few people online here. Let's go to one of my personal favourites, Mr. Kenny Beats Raid. Kenny Beats. He was making some beats. So let's go over to him. Thanks for watching. I will... Oh, I'm out on Friday, so I'll probably do one on Saturday day for an hour or something. Come back on. Just chat shit for a bit. So yeah, have a good one, guys. I'll see you next time. Cheers, bye.